let's talk a little bit about Real Madrid and Barcelona, the two great Spanish football clubs. Real Madrid beaten badly by Manchester City, only 2-1 on the score sheet. But I thought it was the worst Real Madrid team I'd ever seen, Richard. And Rafael Varane, a French World Cup winner, who looked such a great player when he first went to Real Madrid, was responsible for both goals, the second one more even than the first. Sergio Ramos, their captain, leader, and centre-half, who's normally beside Varane, was suspended for the match, which would explain at least partly the Real Madrid performance. And the other sort of extraordinary fact is that Gareth Bale, who's earning something like, I think you know the real figure, 16, 17 million a year after tax.
Exactly.
Yeah, he said he didn't want to travel to Manchester, and there was a video I saw of him playing golf that morning. How have Real Madrid found themselves in this terrible situation where they're paying a guy to play golf? More than most golfers ever earn in their life.
Yeah, you rightly set it up. They were atrocious against Man City. It was more them being bad than City being good. There are a couple of villains in the piece. Bale is certainly one of them. Rafael Varane, don't fuck with me. Rafa was the headline in Diario AS on Saturday, about his shocking performance. Zidane has come under a lot of criticism. We could go back to him, I think, to just contextualise the defeat.
Yeah, I mean, he's a legendary figure in football, Richard. He, as a player, of course, a World Cup winner, European Championship winner, and as a coach at Real Madrid, I think it's 3 Champions League titles to his name. But he allows this situation with Bale, for example, to drag on. Sorry, I interrupted you. Tell me about Zidane.
Yeah, no, they're both connected. We'll deal with the Bale incident first, which is very interesting. So he had a meeting with Zidane on last Wednesday. The game was on Friday. And he asked Zidane, he said, am I going to be playing against City? And Zidane said, no. So then he said, well, can I sit out the game? And Zidane said yes. So then Zidane walked into the press conference, the pre-match press conference, and he was asked about Bale, and he just threw him under the bus. He said he doesn't want to play. So they have had a really bad relationship going back years during Zidane's first tenure as coach when he won those 3 European Cups on the trot. When Zidane walked out dramatically in the summer of 2018, one of the sticking points was that the club, specifically the president, wanted to hold on to Ronaldo, or wanted to get rid of Ronaldo and hold on to Bale. Zidane was of the other opinion. So Zidane comes back in for his second coming March of last year, and the club was in the horrors. They finished the league campaign 19 points behind Barca, but they were left with an attacking force that had been shorn of Cristiano Ronaldo. So he had to make do with Bale, even though he tried to force him out that summer. Made this famous comment on a preseason tour in the States. If Bale goes tomorrow, the better. But the club pulled out of a deal to send Bale to China on a free transfer, get him off the wage bill, which is costing like 30 million in net a season, 17 or 18 million gross he's taken home. Wow. But they decided to keep him on, and there was good reason. Bale is one of the greatest players of the last 10 years, you know, you would think. He's scored iconic goals for Real Madrid.
Yeah, I mean, one against Liverpool I can think of in the Champions League, an overhead kick from about 30 yards, which was mesmerising.
Mesmerising, exactly. Hard to think of a better goal. And he scored effectively the winner in the 2014 final as well, against Atletico Madrid. But he scored he's stepped up in big games, a famous cup-winning goal against Barca in 2014 as well. But his name is absolutely mud in Madrid and around Spain with Real Madrid fans. And it's really sad.
Is it true, Richard, that although he's been there 5 or 6 years, he doesn't speak any Spanish?
Yeah, he does. He's been there. He's been here 7 years now.
Wow.
So, yeah, Marcelo, I mean, would joke that he used to speak with him in sign language. I suppose it's the way of the world now. It's so globalized. He's in a dressing room with a lot of English speakers, the likes of Toni Kroos and Luka Modric and what have you, but he gets by. But that definitely has not helped him assimilate. He's not unpopular in the Real Madrid dressing room. The players get on well with him, but he just has not engaged with the Spanish public, with the Real Madrid fans, and he keeps putting his foot in it. There was this infamous episode last November when Wales qualified for the Euros. He was seen on the pitch with holding aloft this giant flag, which has become a catchphrase here. Wales golf Real Madrid, and then in brackets in that order, and so that that tells you. Yeah. You mentioned he was playing golf last Friday when Real Madrid were in City getting ready for the Champions League game. So he hasn't endeared himself to the public, and you would really have to question him his kind of approach, like. He's been filmed several times leaving the stadium when he's not fit, leaving early before the end of games, you know, to beat the traffic.
Yeah.
The optics are terrible. Ramos, for all his sins, he was in the stands on Friday night watching on.
Yes. You know,
in their supporting. I mean, they're not asked to do much, these players. Like, so the sense of solidarity he has with his club, and they're very tribal here in Spain. You know, the players all the time, Real Madrid players talk about the crest, the shields that they refer to it as. Bale doesn't have that in him. You know, he's distracted. And ultimately, look, this is a guy, he's 31, he's injury plagued. He gave a very revealing interview, a golf interview, funnily enough, back in the spring. It was published or broadcast, and it was about golf, but the interviewer lured him onto football, and he admitted that his ankles are held on by shreds effectively now. He's torn his ligaments so much. So he's had a problem with fitness going back 5 or 6 years, and he's only scored 2 league goals this season. So that really hurt Real Madrid. Benzema has stepped up to the plate. He's been excellent again this season, 27 goals. He had 30 last season in a worse campaign for Real Madrid. But outside of that, there's nowhere else the goals are coming from. Hazard, the player who's bought to replace Cristiano Ronaldo, one goal for 100 million. Meanwhile, Ronaldo was at the same time banging in 2 goals against Lyon. He scored 31 in 33 league games this season in Italy. So the press are hammering that point home. This was a divorce that didn't work out for either Cristiano or Real Madrid. And Hazard has been called a super fiasco.
He turned up for training after that 100 million transfer. I think he was a stone overweight. At his best, a very good player.
Yeah, he's been criticised a lot for that all week about turning up overweight back last summer. People are saying it was inexcusable, and rightly so. So he's 29 now. We don't know. He was clutching his ankle after the game on Friday night. So we don't know how he's going to return when the season is supposed to kick off again in September.
We should point out, Richard, that Real Madrid have just won the Spanish League.
True, yes.
And it's ridiculous. It's crazy. But I want to get on to Barcelona, who play Bayern Munich on Friday night in what should be a hell of a game and may well produce the winner of this year's Champions League, which is being played in Portugal in one-off games. And Barcelona were comfortable winners against Napoli last week. I watched the match, Richard, and Messi scored a wonderful, wonderful goal. They were missing Busquets, who was suspended, and Vidal, who was suspended. Can we take it that Busquets and Vidal will come back into the team? Because they looked a little light, despite the fact that they won the game comfortably enough.
Yeah, that's the choice question. I mean, Napoli are seventh in Serie A, so Bayern Munich is a completely different proposition. But yeah. That's a key question, whether Busquets definitely will start, whether both of them come back in. What people are asking is, should Kikisetti and the coach go with a 4-4-2, which makes sense. The midfield is really porous, Barca's midfield.
Yes.
And that would mean sacrificing Griezmann up front, because Suarez and Messi are untouchable. Gattuso, the Napoli coach and a World Cup winner with Italy back in 2006, he said after the game, look, this Barca team, it's not the team it was 8 years ago. They're playing with three guys who don't press. It makes them really, really yes. vulnerable. They're old men now, the six, seven of that team, well into their 30s. Several times over the last 3 years in the big games, in the Champions League games, when they've been knocked out by Juventus, Roma, most famously against Liverpool last year. And for example, in the Super Cup semi-final against Atletico back in January, it was a brilliant game. They were well on top of Atletico, playing really well. But in 10 minutes, Atletico just rolled over them and they scored two goals. And you could see the rabbits in the headlights.
Yes.
The sensation. This is a really brittle Barca team.
Right.
So that is the problem. So I imagine the only chance they have is to try and block up midfield. Bayern Munich have been electric all season. I mean, 26 wins in 27 games. They absolutely destroyed Chelsea in that first leg back in Stamford
Bridge.
Yeah,
and they destroyed Spurs in London 7-2 in the league stages of the Champions League. So they're pretty formidable opposition. And they're playing a team that finished behind a rather poor Real Madrid team as well. So there wouldn't be a lot of optimism, but they have Lionel Messi.
Yeah.
And that's that can cover a multitude of weaknesses.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, The thing is, this Barca team has good players. Like these, there's still several of these players who are really good. And what they've been talking about them all season is a team of great players, but not a great team. But,
yeah.
But definitely, it all. There have been moments where they've been really good, but during the season. But definitely, it does all hinge on Messi. People are casting their minds back to the 2014 World Cup when Messi dragged a really average Argentina team to the final. That's what they're hoping, that they can win this. It's only 90 minutes. It's a one-off game against Bayern Munich, that he can do something miraculous. You mentioned that goal he got at the weekend against Napoli.
It
was just incredible.
Piece of magic.
Oh, yes. He's amazing. And he effectively scored a hat-trick in the first half with the VAR goal and the penalty he created. Everything hinges on him. But the thing is, there will come a moment of truth during the game. This Bayern team is so exciting that you would really worry about their defence, that midfield, the runners through the centre midfield. They're vulnerable as hell.
Okay, Richard, it's been great to talk to you, and we're very grateful to you for talking to us from Barcelona. And of course, the COVID pandemic is having a terrible effect on a great nation. Thank you very much for bringing us news of that. And of course, the news of the football, which in itself is bizarre. And let's hope Messi can do something. But I've backed Bayern Munich, Richard. Let's hope we win. We're very grateful to you for talking to us today.